Now we are discussing a topic which is named as quality of service, or in the short form we say it is QoS. In the network, the QoS or the quality of service is very much important, because whenever we are going to communicate from sender to receiver, what is the quality of the network we are providing to the subscriber, and what is the communication medium, and what is the quality of that? So that is very much important. Now, if I talk about the quality of service, then QoS is an inter-networking issue which can be defined as the flow which is for the communication. Or we can understand with the help of a simple diagram. Let us suppose that we are having two systems. We are having the first system, let us suppose that this is the sender, and we are having another system which is the receiver. So these are the two systems and they are connected. So this one is the receiver. Now if they are connected with each other and sender is going to send the data to the receiver, now in this medium, how much flow means the data that need to be sent, that flow which is required for the communication, this is the quality of service. Means whenever two systems are there, one is sending the data to the other. Now what should be the flow, that should be decided. If sender is giving very fast data, receiver is not able to accept it, then it is not a good network. Or if sender is very much slow and receiver is very much fast, then again it is not a good network. So there should be some kind of flow. Flow means the speed, bandwidth, reliability, all the things on which the data is moving, that should be decided, which gives the quality of service. So here in the quality of service, we are having the flow characteristics. Flow characteristics stands for means what are the characterizations of the flow which is required. So if we see in the diagram, we can see that the flow characteristics means whatever the data we are sending, that is the flow, what are their features. Now the features required are reliability, delay, jitter and bandwidth. So first of all, we are going to discuss the first feature, which is the reliability. So now we are discussing the reliability. Now reliability means how reliable our network is. Now if we say that network is reliable, that means the packet loss is less. If the packet loss is less, obviously the retransmission will be less, so the network is more reliable. But lack of reliability means losing more packets and the acknowledgement, which result into the retransmission of those packets. We can assume one thing, that if there is a sender and a receiver, sender is sending the data to the receiver, many of the times the data which is flowing from sender to receiver, those packets become lost. Or maybe the packets received by the receiver, now their reply, which is the acknowledgement, that become lost. If that happen continuously, we have to retransmit those packets. If multiple times retransmission going on, then the reliability is reduced. That means the network quality is not good. And the different applications has different reliability. Means if we talk about the different appliances, then it is not like that all the applications need the same reliability. The reliability can be more at some places or at less at some places. So if we talk about the email, file transfer, or maybe internet access, for that we need the more reliability. Because if we are going to send an email or we are sending a file to other person, then we cannot wait for the packets to be not sent. Or maybe we are waiting for the packet or waiting for the acknowledgement. No, that cannot happen. The packet should be exactly transferred, because we are accessing the internet or sending the mail. There should be no packet loss, or it should be minimum. So here in these services, the reliability should be more. But if you talk about the telephony or the audio conferencing, it need less reliability. Because if we are going to communicate with some person through the audio or the telephone, then here if there is some lag, it is not as important as we are accessing the internet or sending the file. So there in the telephony or audio conferencing, the reliability can be less. So this is the reliability, which is the first feature under the flow statistics, which can improve the quality of service. Now we are discussing the next flow statistics, which is the delay. So now we are discussing the delay, which is the part of flow statistics. Delay is the time taken to transmit a packet from source to destination in a flow. Means whenever we are sending a data from source to destination, now how much time the packet take from source to destination, that is called the delay. Now delay can be many, because if we are sending the data, how much time for the receiving that data, so delay can be many. And one more thing which is important, that the different application tolerate delay in different degrees. We know that we are having various applications, but it is not that every application want that the delay should be minimum. No, we know that delay should be minimum for the overall communication, but many applications says that it is not a problem that if some delay is happening. Just like if we take the example of telephony, audio conferencing, video conferencing, or the remote login, now they need the minimum delay. If we take the example of video conferencing, let us suppose that I am talking to a person on a video chat. Now there, my video is reaching to my friend after 5 minutes. Is it a proper video conferencing? No. So delay means the time for sending, that should be minimum. Or if I am speaking to someone, maybe on telephone, or I am on the audio conferencing, now here also, there should be minimum delay, because if I am speaking, that person is getting my words after 10 minutes. Obviously, that is not possible. That is not a conversation. Same in the remote login. Remote login means whenever I am connecting my system to the remote system and I am accessing that system. Now, if that system is giving some command, now this is not reaching to my system on time. Obviously, it is not a good system. So there, in these applications, the delay means time should be minimum. But there are some applications which do not need a minimum delay. Just like if we say file transfer, email, then they may take the more delay. Just like if we see the example of email, if I'm sending an email to my friend, now that email is reaching maybe 5 minutes after the specific time, or maybe it is reaching maybe half an hour delay, not a problem, because that is not harming something. Similarly, file transfer, if I am sending the file, that is reaching after 5 minutes, not a problem. So in these applications, delay can be more, but in the audio video conferencing, the delay should be minimum. So here, that is all about the delay. Now we are discussing the next flow statistics, which is the jitter. So now we are learning the next flow statistics, which is the jitter. Jitter is the variation in packet delay. Now to understand this jitter, let us suppose that we are having an example where we are having the 4 packets. Let us suppose that the packet's name we are giving, that it is packet P1, P2, P3 and P4. Now these packets are at source place. Now let us suppose that at a time 0, 1, 2 and 3, at this specific time, this is the packet departure time. Packet departure time means these 4 packets started communicating at this particular time, 0, 1, 2 and 3. Now from source destination, these packets arrive. Now they have arrived at the destination, and now the packet arrival time for P1, P2, P3 and P4 is, let us suppose that it is 20, 21, 22 and 23. Let us suppose that this is the packet arrival time. If we see minutely, we can see that the packet which started at 0 reached at 20, means the difference is 20. The packet started at 1, reach as 21, again the difference is 20. Which started at 2, reach as 22, again difference is 20. Started at 3, reach at 23, again difference is 20. So there the delay is same, or we can say that it is having the same delay of 20. Now let us suppose that we are taking a case 2. In the case 2, there is not the same delay. Maybe the packet arrived at situation at time 21, 23, again 21 and 28. So this is the case 2 where we are having the new packet arrival time. Now if we compare, the packet started at 0, now reached as 21, so there the difference is 21. Packet started at 1, reached at 23, so here difference is 22. Packet started at 2, reached at 21, so there difference is 19. Packet started as 3, reached at 28, so here difference is 25. That means this is the different delay, and different delays of 21, 22, 19 and 25. Now this different in delay, it is called the jitter. So here whenever we are reaching the packets and in between the packets, the delivery time means the delay is having the different gaps. So this comes the jitter. Now this jitter comes of two types. If we talk about the first type, then here we are having the first category, which is called the high jitter. Talking about the high jitter, obviously we know that the difference between the delays is called jitter. If the difference between delay is very high, it will be high jitter. So we can say that the difference between delay is large. Then afterward we are having the next type of jitter, which is called as low jitter. At the reverse of the high jitter, whenever the difference between delay is small, it is called the low jitter. As we know that the jitter is basically the difference between the delay. If more delay, that means the network is less quality. So here we should understand that jitter should be less in the flow. If jitter is less, obviously delay will be the less. If the difference between delay is less, obviously packet will reach at the specific time and it will be the smooth packets. So that is all about the jitter. Now we are discussing the next flow characteristics, which is the bandwidth. So now we are discussing the bandwidth, which is the part of flow characteristics. If we talk about the bandwidth, then bandwidth is the number of bits that we send. Means if we are having a sender and the receiver and they are connected with a transmission medium. Now with that medium, how many bits of data we can send? That is called the bandwidth. And the bandwidth requirement for the different application is different. Or we can say that different application need the different bandwidth. Just like if we take the example of video conferencing. In the video conferencing, we need the high bandwidth. Because we know that the video is the combination of different images. If we are sending a video in the video conferencing, multiple images got changed. So in that means, there it is sending the millions of the bits per second to refresh the color screen. And that color screen refreshes multiple times, then our image movement comes here, and this image movement result into the video. So video is made up of images, and images is made up of different pixels, and these pixels should be refreshed at very high speed. So for the high speed, we have to send the millions of bits in a second, and because of that, the bandwidth should be very high for the video conferencing. Now the next example we are having is the email. And obviously, email need very less bandwidth. In the email, we have to send few bits only in particular second. So because of that, the bandwidth requirement is very less. So these are the four features which are required for the flow characteristics. The first one is reliability, means the network should be more reliable. The packet loss should be less. The acknowledgement should receive on time so that there should be less retransmission. So reliability of network should be very good. Now talking about next thing is delay. Delay means the time gap for reach the packet. Now the delay should be less into the good transmission. Talking about the jitter. Jitter means difference in delay. Now whenever we are sending the flow of continuous packets, they reach to the destination at different time. Now that time should be minimum. So jitter should be minimum. Now talking about the last thing which we have recently discussed, that is the bandwidth. Bandwidth means how many bits we can send through the transmission medium, more the bits we can send, more the quality of service will increase. So these are the four features of the flow characteristics. Now, based upon these four features, which is reliability, delay, jitter, and bandwidth, which are actually the flow characteristics, we define the flow classes. So now we are learning the flow classes. So if we talk about the flow classes, then based upon the flow characteristics, the flow are classified into some groups, with each group having the similar type of characteristics. We know that we are having the flow characteristics just like the reliability, delay, jitter, and bandwidth. Now, based upon these flow characteristics, we create some groups. Let us suppose that this is having one group. Let us suppose this is G1, and this may be the another group. Let us suppose this is the G2. Now, in this group, we are putting the same type of the applications. Like, let us suppose that in the G1, we are having those applications which are having the same reliability and the delay. Or maybe in the group 2, we are having the applications which are having the same type of jitter and the bandwidth. So those different applications which are having the same type of characteristics of flow, that means same reliability or maybe the same delay or maybe same jitter or same bandwidth. Now these different groups are called the flow classes. So we just divide the different application into the groups. And those are having the similar type of flow characteristics. This is called the flow classes. So this is whole about the quality of service. And based upon this flow characteristics and flow classes, we can improve the quality of service. Now we are discussing the topic, which is techniques to improve the quality of service, or QoS. We know that whenever we are sending the data from source to destination, then there is a medium between source and destination, and from that medium we have to decide the flow of data. Now that flow of data decides the quality of service in terms of the performance, reliability, bandwidth, delay, jitter. So there are multiple things that need to be improved. Now this cumulative thing is called the quality of service. And now we are discussing that what are those techniques by which we can improve the quality of service, means we can improve the performance of the network. So here, if we talk about improving the QoS, then there are majorly four areas. The number one is the scheduling. Second one is the traffic shaping. Then afterward is the resource reservation. Then is the admission control. Every area is having their own specification, just like scheduling. Scheduling is like we are going to schedule everything, and in that scheduling we are having different types, like FIFO queuing, priority queuing, then weighted fare queuing. So these are the subtypes of the scheduling. Then talking about the traffic shaping, means if the traffic or the bulky traffic coming to the network, then how can we shape that? Then this is are the algorithms like leaky bucket or the token bucket. So these are the further categories of the traffic shaping. Then we are having the resource reservation, means whatever the resources are required, just like we need a buffer. So those resources should be reserved in advance. This is called the resource reservation. Then further we are having is the admission control, means whosoever the data coming to our network, we should control it. So these are the ways by which we can improve the QoS. Now we are going to do the detailed discussion on this improving QoS. First of all, we are discussing the scheduling. So here we are starting with improving the QoS. In the QoS, we are discussing the first technique, which is the scheduling. As the name signifies, scheduling means there is some kind of schedule is there. So we know that the packets come from the different flows and they arrive at the switch or the router for the processing. To make you understand about this particular line, we are first of all taking a diagram. Let us suppose that we are having a router. This one is a router. Let us suppose that in the router we are having the three incoming lines. This is one, this is 2, and this one is 3. So these are the three incoming lines into the router. And let us assume that there is one outgoing line which is connected to the router. Now this line says that packet from different flows. So let us suppose that this is the flow 1, from where the data is coming. This is the flow 2, this is the flow 3. So here the data is coming to the router, and now afterward router process this data and send to the outer line. Now these different lines from which the data is coming to the router, router should give everybody the proper time in a fair manner. That is called the scheduling, or we can say that scheduling treat the different flows in a fair and the appropriate manner. The flow stands for the data flow. Let us suppose that this is the flow 1, flow 2 and flow 3. Now out of these flows the data is coming, the data flow is coming, and now through the outgoing line the data will go. So scheduling provide everybody a fair chance. So this is how the scheduling work. Now we are discussing the different types of the scheduling so that we can improve the quality of service. So there are three types of scheduling by which we can improve the quality of service. The first of all, we are having the FIFO queuing. So now we are going to discuss the first category of scheduling, which is called the FIFO queuing. So now we are discussing the first type of scheduling, which is the FIFO queuing. So by this technique, we can improve the quality of service. First of all, we should understand that FIFO stands for first in, first out. Means whosoever will come first will get the chance first to be executed. Now talking about the FIFO queuing, here the packet wait in the buffer until the processor is ready to process them. To understand this, first of all we are focusing on the diagram. In the diagram we can see that there is a processor. Processor is nothing but the router. We know that router is the place where all the flows comes. So on this device, all the flows are connected and it takes the decision which flow will be going further. So this is the processor or the router. Now afterward we are having the queue. Queue is nothing but the buffer. Buffer is just like a queue where data is stored. It is a small piece of memory where we can store the data. Whenever the data packets are coming, now they are stored into the buffer or the queue. We can see that at this time there are three data packets which are present into the buffer or the queue. Whenever a new data packet comes, it is called arrival. Arrival means the new data packet is coming here. So it will come inside. Now there is a decision. Decision is going to check whether the queue is full or not. You can see that at this time only three elements are present. Otherwise, all the remaining the queue or the buffer is not full. So here, if the queue is full, if it is yes, then it will discard the packets. If it is not full, in that case, those packets will come inside and they will be stored. Just like we have stored the three packets, 1, 2, and 3. So these three packets are stored into the queue. So these are the three data packets which are stored into the queue or the buffer. Now afterward, whenever the processor becomes ready, now this processor or the router take out the packet one by one and then process them. And then afterward, the packets goes out after processing. This is the departure. So this is how the FIFO queuing work. If the arrival rate is higher than the processing rate, means more packets are coming inside and processor is not processing the packets, then what will happen? The queue will become full and the new packets which will come will be discarded. So if the arrival rate is very much high, that means packets are coming at very high speed and the processor is not processing them at the same speed. Now what will happen? Then all the buffer will be filled, means all the buffer will be having the data packets. And if all the data packets are filled into the buffer, then those data packets which are coming extra will be discarded afterward. So this is the way the FIFO queuing work. This is the first technique in the scheduling. And now we are discussing the next technique under the scheduling, which is the priority queuing. So now we are discussing the next scheduling technique to improve the QoS, that is the priority queuing. Well, as the name signifies priority, that means there is some kind of priority is given to some of the packets. Some will be of high priority, which will be processed first. Some will be of low priority, which will be processed later on. So the first thing into the priority queue is that the packets are assigned the priority classes. Means in the priority class, the packets are assigned. Then afterward, each priority class has its own queue. Just like in the diagram, we can see that there are two queues available. One is the queue for the higher priority queue, and second one we are having is the queue for the lower priority queue. So similar way, there can be multiple queues. Just like here in the diagram, we have assumed that there are high and the low priority, but there can be three queues also: high priority, low priority, or medium priority. So here in the diagram, we have taken the two, high and the low priority. Now, these packets in high priority queue are processed first. Means let us suppose that in the high priority queue, there are three packets available, 1, 2, and 3. Now, these three packets will be processed by the processor first. Here, the processor is taking the first chance to the high priority queue, because the high priority means they are the process with some high priority. So the processor will give the chance to the high priority processes, and the packets in the lower priority queue are processed the last. Here in the diagram, we can see that there is another queue, which is the low priority. Now there you can see that more packets are present. So they are waiting for their turn, because first of all, the chance will be given to the high priority. Then afterward, they will get processed by the processor. Now we are going to understand this diagram. So you can see that there are two queues available. One is the high priority queue and second one is the low priority queue. Now, before that, we are having the classifier. Classifier is going to classify the data or the incoming packets. So the first thing is the arrival. Let us suppose that some of the new packet is coming. So that come to the arrival. Now after the arrival of packet, they go to the classifier. Now classifier find out whether this packet is of high priority or the low priority. Now first of all, we are assuming that classifier find that this is some system packet and this is should be given the high priority. So it will go and check for the high priority. It will check whether the high priority process is full. If that queue is full, in that case the packet will be discarded. If the queue is not full, it will be going and entering to the queue, high priority queue there. So there the packets will be taken. Similarly, for the low priority process, the process will be taken. But first we are going through the high priority. Now afterward, the high priority process, once the packet is added, we can see that the processor is having a switch. So this is a switch. Now this switch is turned on to the high priority process, means this arrow is pointing to the high priority. The switch turns to the other queue when the current one is empty. So here we can see that first of all the switch is on the high priority. So this processor will take out all the processes of high priority and process them one by one. Now assume that this time the high priority process is completely empty. So if it is completely empty, then this switch will turn to the low priority. So the next time this switch will become to the low priority. Now you assume that classifier find that there is some kind of low priority process coming. So it will again check whether the low priority queue is full. If it is full, yes, then those packets will be discarded. If it is not full, in that case, the packets will be keep on adding to the low priority queue. Now you can see that the processor switch is pointing towards the low priority, because we assume that the high priority queue is empty this time. So now these packets will be taken by the processor, and every packet of high or the low priority will be going to the departure. Departure means exit. So by this diagram, we can understand one thing, that The classifier is going to divide the packets into two parts, high priority and low priority. And if any of the queue is full, high or the low, those will be discarded. Processor will first of all give the priority to the high priority queue and process all the high priority packets. If high priority queue is completely empty, then afterward the processor will go to the low priority queue. So this one is the working of the priority queue. Now we are going to discuss the advantage of priority queue. If we compare the priority queuing with the FIFO queuing, then the priority queue can provide the better quality of service than the FIFO queuing, because we know that the multimedia packets, multimedia means video, these packets will be processed first and they will be having the less delay. Then in that case, we will be having the best video quality. So if we talk about this priority queue, then priority queue obviously become the better than the FIFO queuing for the high priority. Means if you are sending the multimedia like video, audio, songs we are sending, and you know that they need a minimum delay, because if you are watching a video on the YouTube, then the buffering should be very less. Buffering means there should be very minute delay so that you can continuously watch the video. If the video you are watching on the YouTube and it is hanging in between, it is going to the buffer, then you will not enjoy the video. So minimum delay should be there. And if you talk about the priority queue will give the more priority to the high priority. High priority means multimedia and such type of things. So in that case, the priority queue will become the better than the FIFO queuing. But here, if you talk about the drawbacks or the disadvantages of priority queuing. So now we are discussing the disadvantage or the drawback of the priority queuing. We can understand one thing, that the priority queue give more priority to the higher priority queuing. But let us suppose that the packets are keep on coming to the high priority only, then low priority packets will never get the chance. So we can say that if there is a continuous flow in high priority queue, the packets of low priority queue will never get the chance to processed. And this thing is called the starvation. So the major problem with the priority queuing is the starvation. Starvation means you assume that at the arrival, there are all the high priority packets are coming and the classifier is going to classify them to the high priority, and they are reaching to the high priority queue only. So there are multiple packets who are waiting into the high priority queue and processor is going to process them. So from here, it is going to the processor and processor are keep on processing those packets only, and they are going to the departure. Now you can see that in this whole process, the low priority packets are still waiting. Now these packets will never get the chance to get executed. So if they are not getting the chance to execute it, only the high priority packets will be keep on executing and low priority packets are waiting into the queue. This is called the starvation. So new high priority packets are coming, they got the chance, but the old packets which are still into the queue of the low priority, they are still waiting. So these packets are starved. Starved means they are into the continuous waiting. So that is called the starvation, which is the major disadvantage of the priority queuing. Now we are discussing the next type of scheduling, which is the weighted fare queuing. So now we are discussing the weighted fare queuing, and this is the technique for improving the QoS under the scheduling. By the help of this weighted fare queuing, we can improve the quality of service of the network. If we talk about the weighted fare queuing, then this one is the best scheduling method. In the initial terms, the weighted fare queuing is just similar like the priority queuing. So here the packets are assigned to the different classes and also admitted to the different queues. We know that in the priority queue, we was having the different priorities, just like high priority queue and the low priority queue, and there the packets were also divided into the different types, means high priority packet and the low priority packets. Similarly here in the weighted fair queuing, we are having the different classes. Now class can be of high priority, low priority and medium priority, and these classes are having their own queues. The different weights are assigned to the queues based on their priority. The weights are assigned in such a manner that the high priority is having the high weight. So here in the diagram we can see that there are three queues available. One is having the weight 3. Weight 3 means we know that this is the high priority queue. Then afterward we are having the weight 2, that means this is the medium priority queue. And then we are having the weight 1, that means the low priority. So the queues are there and the queues are having their weights. So more weight means more the priority. The system is going to process these packets of every queue in round robin fashion, means one by one, with the number of packets selected from each queue based upon the corresponding weight. The meaning is that if the high priority is having the weight 3, that means there the 3 packets will be selected for the processing by the processor. Now if the medium priority is having the weight 2, that means 2 packets will be selected for the processing when the chance will come. And the low priority is having the weight 1, that means only 1 packet will be processed. So this way, whenever the queue turn will come, the number of packets depending upon the weight will be taken. So all the queues will be given chance one by one, and the packets will be selected and processor will process it. In the priority queue, we know that only one queue was giving the high priority. And if the packets are keep on coming in that queue high priority, then the problem comes. And that problem is called the starvation. That means the low priority queue never get the chance. But that problem is removed in the weighted fair queuing, because in the weighted fair queuing, all the queues will be getting chance one by one. And once the chance of high priority will come, then from there, as per their weight, 3 packets will be taken. If the chance of medium will come, as per their weight, 2 packets will be taken. And when the chance of low will come, as per their weight, 1 packet will be taken. So everybody will be given the fair chance, as well as the priority is also maintained. So the starvation problem never comes in the weighted fair queuing. That's why the weighted fair queuing is the better than all other queuing. We can consider one more case. If we are not providing the priority here, means we are not assigning the weight like 3 to 1, then all the weights will be equal. Then this will work in the normal fashion. No priority will be given to anyone. Or we can say that if the system does not impose any priority on the classes, then all the weights will be equal. So if we understand the weighted fair queuing, then in that we should understand that all the packets which are coming, means they are the arrival. Now they are sent to the classifier. Now this classifier is going to classify based upon their priority. So there are 3 priorities which are assigned here. One is the high, medium and low. Now based upon these priority, the weights are given 3, 2 and 1. So these are the weights they are given. Now every weight is having their own queue. So these are the 3 queues which are available, one for the high, one for the medium and one for the low, with their own weights. Now every particular queue is having a checker. If the classifier classify to the first priority, means the high priority, if that queue is full, then the packet is discarded, otherwise it will enter into the high priority. If the packet is of medium priority, if the queue is full, then it will be discarded, otherwise it will go to the medium priority. If the packet is marked as the low priority, if the queue is full for the low priority, then it will be discarded, otherwise it will be sent to the queue. All the queues are having their own weights. Now based upon their weights, the number of packets will be taken by the processor. So this is like a routing switch. Now you can see that whenever the switch is on the first line, So here the three packets from there will be taken because their weight is 3. Whenever the turn of next will come, then from there two packets will be taken. When the turn of next will come, it will take the one packet. So this way the switch or the router will keep on moving and the processor will process and then the departure. This is a turning switch. So the turning switch select the three packets from the first queue, two packets from the second queue, and one packet from the third queue. And this cycle keep on repeat. And processor will take out these packets and then send. So this is the weighted fair queuing, which is better than the FIFO and the priority queuing. So that is all about the scheduling, where we have discussed the three techniques to improve the quality of service of the network. The first technique we have used is FIFO queuing. Second technique we have learned is priority queuing. And the third technique we have learned is weighted fair queuing. By using these techniques, we can improve the quality of service of the network. Now we are discussing the next technique to improve the quality of service, that is traffic shaping. Now we are discussing the technique to improve the QoS, which is the traffic shaping. We know that in the network, the quality is very much important. Quality in terms of what is the performance, what is the speed, how much delay the network takes. Now to improve all these parameters, we are having different techniques like scheduling, traffic shaping, resource reservation, admission control. So here we are discussing the technique, which is the traffic shaping. So in the improving quality of service, we are having the traffic shaping as a technique, which is further having the mechanism like leaky bucket and the token bucket. So first of all, we understand what is the traffic shaping. Traffic shaping is a mechanism to control the amount and the rate of traffic sent to the network. Means how much rate or how much data that can pass through the traffic, that is taken care by the traffic shaping. Means how much traffic we can pass through the network, that is taken care by the traffic shaping mechanism. There are two types of traffic shaping mechanism which are available. The first one we are having is the leaky bucket, and the second one we are having is the token bucket. So these are the two mechanism. Now we are going to discuss the first mechanism, which one is the leaky bucket. Now we are discussing the first mechanism of traffic shaping, which is the leaky bucket. So you can see that there is a diagram where we are having a tap. To understand this, we are taking this diagram. Now the tap is available. You can see that from the tap the water is flowing, and this water is coming inside the bucket. So this one is our bucket, and the name of bucket is given as the leaky bucket, because at the bottom of the bucket there is a hole. Now understand the concept. The concept says that you can see the from the hole the data is coming out. That means if we take the real life example, let us suppose that we are having a leaky bucket, from that the water is coming out. Now the hole is of fixed size. That's why the water which is coming is having the fixed flow. So whatever the water will come here, it is having the fixed flow. But from the tap, the water can come at any of the flow. Means there is no restriction, because at the top side of the bucket, it is having the open. Now here the water will come inside and fill. That means from the tap, we can have the bursty flow. Means bursty water can come inside the bucket, but from the bucket, the water which will come out, it is having the fixed flow. The same concept is taken in the traffic shaping by the help of the leaky bucket. If we are putting the data into the buffer, let us suppose that this leaky bucket is like some buffer. Now here we are not putting the water, we are putting the data inside. Now that data can come at any of the flow. Any of the flow means it can be having the bursty data, but at the outside the data will come at the fixed flow. So the bursty data will be converted to the fixed flow data. So that is the concept behind the leaky bucket. Means in the bucket we are putting the water at any of the speed. Maybe if we are saying that it can be of 100 Mbps, 20 Mbps, any of the speed the data is coming, but whenever the data will come out, it will be having the fixed flow. So that is the concept behind the leaky bucket. So we can say that the input rate can vary, but output rate remains the constant. Just like the water can come at any of the speed, but water will come out at the fixed speed. Similarly, input data can come at any of the speed, but output data will be at the constant speed. So we can say that it smooths out the bursty traffic. Smoothing the traffic means shaping the traffic. That's why the name is the traffic shaping. Here the bursty chunks are stored in a bucket and sent out at the average rate. So here the bursty data will come and it will come out at the average rate, means the fixed rate will come. Now to understand how it is coming into the real life, we are going to take the example with the help of the diagram. We can see that in the example, there are first 2 seconds. In first 2 seconds, the sender has sent a very huge amount of data, and the huge amount of data is 12 Mbps. So first 2 seconds we are having the data. Let's calculate this. Let us suppose that this 12 Mbps of data is sent for the 2 seconds. So it is multiplied by the 2 seconds. Now afterward, for the next consecutive 5 seconds, it is become silent. So here you can see that it is silent from 2 to 7. For next 5 seconds, it is silent. So this is the silent time where nothing is sent. So we are not considering this time because there is nothing is sent. Now afterward, again, we are having the 2 Mbps of data which is sent by the sender, and that is for the consecutive 3 seconds. From 7 to 10, it is the 3 seconds. So we can say that the 2 Mbps of data is sent for consecutive 3 seconds. Now these are the combined terms. So we are combining together, means 12 Mbps data is sent for 2 seconds. So we can say that 12, if you multiply with 2, then that will become 24 MB. So this is the 24 MB of data is sent. Now plus we are having the silent time. Silent time means there is nothing is sent. So that is zero. Then afterward, we have taken this 2 Mbps for the 3 seconds. So that will become 2 into 3. So that will be 6 MB of the data. So now if we combine this complete data, then that will be equal to nothing but 30 MB of the data. Means in the whole flow, we have sent the 30 MB of data, but this is the variable data. We can see that for some specific time, we have sent the 12 MB of data. Then for some time, we have sent nothing. Then afterward, again, we have sent 2 Mbps of data. So this is the variable data. But at the result, we want the fixed data. So how we can convert this to the fixed data? Now this 30 MB can be divided back. You can see that how much complete time we are taking. It is from 0 to 10, means 10 seconds of the data we are taking. So we can easily combine this one. 30 can be divided into simply 3 Mbps of data, and that is for the 10 seconds. So we can divide it like this. First of all, we have combined this data together and the equivalent becomes, that is 30 MB. Now this 30 MB can be again divided into the specific time through which the data is sent, that is 3 Mbps for the 10 seconds. Now you can see that in the resultant image, we are having the fixed data rate, and that is of 3 Mbps. So first of all, we have collected the bursty data. Now that bursty data is combined, and afterward that is sent for the transmission. So the initially, if we was having the bursty data means sometimes sender is sending, sometime it is not sending. So we are taking this one as the bursty data, and this bursty data we are taking here means you can assume that sometime the water tap is open, sometime it is not open. We are storing the water into a bucket. Similarly, 12 Mbps of data is coming, then silent, then 2 Mbps is coming. We are storing them together into a bucket. Then afterward, this bursty flow is converted to the fixed flow. Similarly, this bursty flow is converted to the fixed rate of data. Now, whatever the data is sent specifically, that is converted back to the fixed data rate. So there we will achieve the speed of 3 Mbps here. So that is the concept behind the leaky bucket, and with the help of this bucket we can easily convert the bursty flow into the fixed flow. Now there is one more case. Let us suppose that the tap is going to fill out the bucket, but the bucket is full. If the bucket is full, if the leaky bucket may drop the packet if the bucket is full. So those packet which are coming extra will be dropped. Or we can say that the leaky bucket may drop the packet if the bucket is full. Now we are understanding that how the leaky bucket can be implemented. So here we can see that there is a queue. Now this queue is nothing but a buffer. So this buffer is acting like the bucket. So from this buffer the data can come. Now first of all we are having the data which is coming inside, that is called the arrival. So data will come here. Now data will be checked that if the bucket is full or not. If the bucket is full, bucket means the buffer here. So if the buffer or the queue is full, then obviously the packet will be discarded, will come downside. If the queue is empty, means some space is available, means bucket is not full or the queue is not full, the data will come here in this direction. Now the data is keep on storing into the queue. Here queue or the buffer is acting like the bucket. So in this bucket or the queue, the data is keep on storing. Now on the other side we are having the processor. Processor is the router that is going to remove the packet at the constant speed. Means this processor is having the clear-cut algorithm which is called the leaky bucket algorithm. So based upon the leaky bucket algorithm, the output flow is fixed. Means processor will take out the data at the fixed speed. Means data come here at any of the way. Means if the data is coming, the rate is the variable rate, or we can say that here the bursty flow is coming. So in this queue the data is coming at the bursty flow or the variable rate, but from this queue the data will come out and that will be the fixed flow. This flow is fixed because the processor is very intelligent and it is based upon the leaky bucket algorithm that it will remove the packet at the constant rate. So now those packet will be the departure. Departure means they will come out. So this is the way the leaky bucket can be implemented. Means the queue will be taking the data at any of the speed, but from the queue data will be taken out at the constant speed. So that is how the leaky bucket algorithm works for the traffic shaping. Here we can see that the traffic is perfectly shaped. Now the next algorithm or the technique in the traffic shaping we are having is the token bucket. Now token bucket is taken because of the disadvantages of leaky bucket. So first of all we are discussing the disadvantages of leaky bucket. So if we talk about the disadvantages of the leaky bucket, then here the leaky bucket is very restrictive. Restrictive in the sense there are so many things imposed that it should be like this, it should not be like this. So there are so many restrictions on working of the leaky bucket. And second thing, that it do not credit an ideal host. Not credit ideal host means whenever the sender is not going to send the data, that is called the ideal time. Now there is no provision given in the leaky bucket that what should we do in that ideal time. Are we giving some advantage to the host if the host is ideal, or what should we do with that? So that thing is not taken care into the leaky bucket. We can assume the case that let us suppose the host is not sending some data. What the leaky bucket do? Leaky bucket will empty itself. So if the host is not sending for a while, then the bucket becomes empty. Now assume one more case. Now if the host has the bursty data, it allows only at the average rate. So in this whole process, the time when the host was ideal is not taken into the account. Now to understand this, I am taking the example. Let us suppose I am a sender. Now, what is the concept of leaky bucket? Leaky bucket says that whenever the data or the bursty data comes, it converts to the fixed flow. Assume I am the sender. I am just sending the data, maybe few MBs of data. Now, afterward, I become ideal. I am doing some other task. What the leaky bucket will do? Leaky bucket is continuously flowing because this is a leaky bucket. Now, what will happen? Until I was waiting, the whole bucket is empty because I am just like a tap. I am not putting any water into the bucket and the bucket is constantly leaking. So what will happen? The bucket will be empty. I was waiting for a few minutes, the bucket is empty. Now again I send with the huge amount of data. Now what will happen? With my huge amount of data, now as per the average, the bucket will again keep on flowing. So that means at that time I was ideal. That is not taken into the consideration. You can assume that the tap is open, the water is coming into the bucket. Now the tap is closed, the water is not coming. But in this specific time, the bucket is keep on putting the water and the bucket becomes empty. Now again we are putting so much water, again the bucket is keep on full coming. So again it will come on the average rate. So means whenever the tap was closed or sender was the ideal, that amount is not taken into the consideration. So there should be some specific principle so that whenever the host is not sending the data into the bucket, for that there should be some credibility given to the host. So it is becoming very restrictive. Means it will keep on giving the data. So these are the disadvantages of the leaky bucket. Because of this problem, we are having the next type of bucket, which is the token bucket. So now to improve the quality of service of the network, under the traffic shaping, we are discussing the next type of bucket, which is the token bucket. So under the traffic shaping, now we are discussing the token bucket. Now as the name signifies, token bucket. So in the bucket, the tokens are generated. The token bucket allows the ideal host to accumulate credit for the future in the form of the tokens. Means whenever the host is ideal, at that time the credit is given to the host. And host has given with some of the tokens that the host can use later on for the communication. So here in the token bucket, the tokens are generated when the host is ideal. And host can use those tokens later on. For each tick of the clock, system send n token to the bucket. Each tick means every second. So every second, n number of tokens are sent to the bucket. The system remove one token for every byte of data is sent. Let us suppose we are taking the example. Let us suppose that the time for the host which was ideal is 100 tick. And we assume that the n means the number of tokens which are collected every tick. And that n is equal to 100. So that means this n is 100, means every tick the tokens collected will be 100. So the total number of tokens collected by the bucket will be 100 into 100. So tokens collected are 100 into 100. Because we know that every tick the n number of tokens are generated and the value of n is 100. And the host was ideal for the 100 ticks. That means 100 into 100, these many tokens are generated. So we can say that 10000 tokens are collected by the bucket when the host was ideal. When in the bucket the tokens become zero, then the host cannot send any data. So here we can see that whenever the host become ideal, the tokens are given to the host. Now with these tokens, the host can send the data. When the tokens become zero, host cannot send the data, and again it becomes the ideal. Now again in that ideal time, the tokens are given, then again host can send the data. So this way the tokens are generated and consumed, and this way the token bucket work. The token bucket allows the bursty traffic at the regulated maximum speed. Means the bursty data is taken. Now at the constant regulated speed, which is the maximum speed, the data is coming out. Now to understand this, we are taking this diagram. In this diagram, we can see that there is a bucket, and in this bucket, the tokens are present. Now these tokens comes whenever the host become ideal. So here one token added per tick. Let us suppose that we have assumed the value of n is 1. So here one token will be added at every tick, means every second one token is added into the bucket. So here the token will be added. Whenever the host is ideal, then the tokens are added into the token bucket. Now in this bucket we are having the tokens. Now here we can see that arrival means first of all the packets will be coming. Now here if the queue is full, queue is a buffer, if that buffer is full, then these packets will be discarded. It will come out because there is no space. If there is a space in queue, then those packets will be stored inside the queue. So let us suppose that we have stored certain packets into the queue. Now the processor or the router will take out the packet only when the tokens are available. So whenever the tokens are present, we can see that into the bucket there are many tokens. So first of all, one token will be taken out of the present tokens. So this one token is taken out, one token removed and discarded per cell transmitted. Means first of all, one token is taken out. Now this token is discarded and one packet will be taken from the queue by the processor, and processor will processes and this departure. Means if the token is available, only then processor will take out the packet from the queue. So this is how the token bucket work. In the token buckets, tokens are generated when the host is ideal. So host was ideal for some time, the tokens are there into the bucket. Afterward, processor takes out token one by one, and for every token it takes out the packet from the queue and process it. If the tokens are not present, processor will not process any of the packet. So this is how the token bucket work. So here we have learned the leaky bucket and the token bucket. There is one more provision that we can combine the token bucket and the leaky bucket. The two techniques can be combined to credit an ideal host and also the regulate the traffic. We know that here we are having the two diagrams. The first diagram we are having is of token bucket, and the second diagram we are having is of leaky bucket. Both the buckets are having their own features. If we talk about the token bucket, then token bucket credit the ideal host. And if we talk about the leaky bucket regulate the traffic. So these two features can be clubbed together by combining the token bucket and the leaky bucket. Means we can credit the ideal host as well as we can regulate the traffic at the same time. So these two things can be combined to achieve the best things together. The leaky bucket is applied after the token bucket, and the rate of leaky bucket need to be higher than the rate of token dropped in the bucket. If this is the scenario where we are applying the leaky bucket after the token bucket and the rate of leaky bucket is higher than the rate of tokens dropped into the bucket, then in that scenario we can achieve the two things together. The one, the credit will be given to the ideal host. Second, traffic will be regulated. So we can achieve these two things together by combining the token bucket and the leaky bucket. So that is all about the token bucket and the leaky bucket into the traffic shaping. Now we are discussing the next technique to improve the quality of service, that is the resource reservation. Resource reservation is a technique to improve the quality of service of the network. In the network, we are having the different parameters, just like delay, traffic, then we are having the performance, reliability. Now these things should be improved, and resource reservation is one of the technique. So here in the improving quality of service, we are having the technique which is resource reservation. As the name signify, means we are going to reserve the resources. The flow of data need resources such as buffer, bandwidth, CPU time. Now these resources are required. So these resources should be beforehand reserved, means before executing any of the thing or sending the data, we should just reserve the buffer, bandwidth and CPU time. So we can say that the quality of service can be improved by reserving these resources beforehand. So the resource reservation says that we should reserve means previously take out those resources which are further required. So beforehand we should reserve those resources which are required in the future, then we can obviously improve the quality of service, because whenever the resources are required, it is available with us. So that's why the resource reservation is very much important for quality of service. Now we are discussing the next technique to improve the quality of service, that is the admission control. So now we are learning the next quality of service parameter, that is admission control. By this parameter or the technique, we can improve the quality of service. Now admission control, it is a mechanism used by the router to accept or reject the flow based upon some predefined parameters, and this is called the flow specification. Means there are some flow specification. Flow specification means there are certain parameters which are defined. If the packet which is coming to the router is following those parameters, means the flow specifications, only then router will take out that packet, means accept it or reject it. If that parameters are not followed, means flow specifications are not followed by those packets, then we will not take out that packet. So this is called admission control. Admission means before taking the packet into the router for sending further, there are certain parameters that need to be followed, which is called the flow specification parameters. And based upon these flow specification parameters, the admission will be taken or not taken. So that is called the admission control. So before accepting a flow for processing, a router first of all check the flow specification to see its capability. The capability like bandwidth, buffer size, CPU speed, etc. And if all these parameters are following and all its previous commitments, they are taken care, then the packets will be taken. So the meaning is that in the admission control, first of all, the router keep on checking the flow specification. Flow specification means whenever the flow or the data is coming to the router, router check the flow specification, which are some parameters. Now parameters like, it will check out its capacity. If the router is having the capacity in terms of the bandwidth, buffer size and CPU speed, if the router is having all those things, now all the parameters are satisfied, then those packet flow will be taken by the router and then process it. If router is committed to somewhere else, then router will not take the upcoming flow of the packets. So that is called the admission control. So if we talk about the admission control, then in the admission control, first of all, the things are checked. Afterward, the packets are taken. Means at the time of admission, the things are checked. And if you talk about the resource reservation, in the resource reservation, whenever we are going to perform any of the flow or sending the packets, first of all, we have to reserve those parameters which are required, just like buffer, bandwidth, CPU time. So by this resource reservation and the admission control, we can improve the quality of service. So these two are the techniques which can improve the quality of service of the network.